Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road here on BCTV, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. My name is Kendra Cook. I'm here this evening with Dan Olsen. Hi, Dan.
Hello.
We've been having a grand old time here this evening so far.
Yeah.
So we're excited to share some cool automotive topics with you. But before we get to that, a little bit about the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. The museum is located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. And we would love to hear from you. You can get in touch with us by giving us a call at 610-367-2090, or feel free to send us an email, mail, at boyertownmuseum.org. Our website is boyertownmuseum.org. If you're on Facebook or Instagram, definitely go find us on there. We post lots of cool photos. We post museum updates and announcements about events and all that cool stuff. And also definitely check out our YouTube channel. BCTV has a YouTube channel. We have a YouTube channel. There's hours of entertainment online. So check us out there. I have lots of cool topics on there as well. If you like some of the stuff we cover here on Wheels Along the Road, you will like the topics that we talk about there as well. The museum is open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. We would love to have you come visit. And, you know, we're always open for just walk-in visitors. If you have a group that you may be looking for a guided tour, we can definitely accommodate you. If you give us a call and schedule your time, and maybe we can find a good tour guide or two, right?
We might be able to find one.
Yeah. We'll, you know, dig them up somewhere.
Yeah.
So we'd love to see you visit the museum. Like I said, open 7 days a week. We are closed major holidays, so the next one coming up is July 4th. So we will be closed July 4th, but other than that, you know, we are open. So we do have some upcoming events that I wanted to mention. So if you could show this, thank you. If you could show the
what
screen
a
there.
Great shot, that is.
I'm so excited for this. This is coming up pretty soon.
Well, not
really.
Just the event, but just what we're looking at.
Everything.
The artwork, the placement of words and the color.
It's just true art, isn't it? Flattered. I'm just
Kendra
flattered.
Did it. Okay, I'm sorry.
It's okay, thank you. You can compliment, that's fine. some of you may have attended this event last year. This was the first time we ever did this was last year. This is a current event. This was our electric vehicle show that we had in our parking lot last year. It was really successful, I think. We had a great turnout of both cars and visitors. So we decided that we should give it another go this year. And here we are. So on Sunday, July 17th, mark it down in your books. That's really not that far off. It's coming at us really fast. From 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., it will be in the museum parking lot. We will have electric vehicles on display from all eras. We're going to have modern ones out, but we're also going to have some antiques, including, I do believe, I think it's a 1914 Detroit. Do I have the year right?
Maybe.
I think it's a 1914.
Maybe.
And
because I forget.
We have some other ones from the teens on mm-hmm. up. Mm-hmm. We're going to bring out some of the pieces in our own collection that really aren't on display much, including that Volkswagen Rabbit there in the lower right corner. Yes, the Volkswagen Rabbit is electric. It was converted by the Boyertown Auto Body Works. So that will be out. And then you see all those yellow cars on a yellow carrier. That is Entropy Racing. So our friends over there at Entropy Racing, they race electric cars. So they are going to bring at least one of their race cars. And we've also been talking to them about doing, let's say, a quote unquote pit demonstration. Mm-hmm. So you want to check that out. And there'll be more event, more details on this event as we get closer. So again, check out our website, go on Facebook. If you're not already doing that and you're on Facebook, come find us and you'll get updates on that event.
And we're still like pursuing vehicles.
We are still looking for other vehicles too. Yeah,
I think we've identified some, but just to pin down the owner, sort of.
Firming up some things.
Know, and, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like CT truck, maybe, hopefully.
Ooh, that would be nice, wouldn't it?
It would be.
Yeah, we have more people to pin down.
Okay.
Whatever else they're doing on Sunday, July 17th, is not nearly as important as this show, they should realize. So yeah, we're excited, and of course there'll be food and ice cream there for sale. If you just want to come to the electric vehicle show and check those vehicles out, you don't have to pay. That part is free. You pay for your food and ice cream, but if you just want to come look at the cars and stuff, that's free of charge. If you want to go in the museum, that's just regular admission. So, you know, it's up to you how you want to do that. So that's event number one. Event number two is a brand new event. We've not done this before. And Dan and I are really excited because, quite frankly, we like ice cream. So this is Cars and Cones, and it will be Thursday, August 11th from 4 to 6:30. Again, in our parking lot, Mr. Softy will be there with his ice cream truck, and there's nothing better on a hot summer night than ice cream.
And so basically,
and cool cars.
It's like a cruise night.
Basically,
With ice cream.
Yep.
And
so originally we were talking about doing a Cars and Coffee.
Right.
That was kind of how this all started. And which is, you know, kind of that idea. You go in, you don't have to stay the whole time. Mm-hmm. You get your coffee, you hang out with your friends, talk, check out the other cars and stuff. But the problem we were having was every Saturday morning we picked, there was a Cars and Coffee going on close by somewhere. And we didn't want to step on anyone's toes and take anyone's people away from them. Or, you know, also not get people because they had their regular places that they go to. Mm-hmm. So we decided to try this instead because we like ice cream. I might like ice cream better than coffee, actually.
How about coffee ice cream?
I'm okay with coffee ice cream. I'll ask Mr. Softy if he has some. So again, if you just want to come and check out the cars in the lot or bring your car, you do not have to pay. We will have the museum open until 6:30. If you want to go in the museum, again, it's just pay the regular admission and you can check out the museum if you want. Mm-hmm. So hopefully we see you at those two events. And that's what I have for now. But I know we got cool history stuff to talk about, don't
cool
we?
Cool history stuff.
Hopefully.
It's cool.
What you got, Dan?
Oh, okay. That means it's time for me to start.
Yeah, I'm going to take a break from talking.
I'm going to start out by, you know, Kendra asked me, when was that, this afternoon?
What
are you doing? Or no, do you have a topic for tonight? And what did I answer?
Searchlight.
No, I just said yes.
Oh.
So, but yeah, true. It's about searchlights. And I'm thinking, oh, okay, great. And it takes me back when I was a kid, okay? And I'm going to say you're too young for this, Kendra, but when I was a kid, there was a lot of World War II surplus stuff, including searchlights. And anytime it seemed like there was a grand opening of something out there in New Jersey, they'd have searchlights. And I remember,
like the,
oh yeah,
kind of like
yeah.
crisscrossing, yeah.
Yeah, and I remember sometimes we would go out as a family trying to find wherever this, because we wouldn't know, you know?
Yeah.
and you get there and it's like the Acme supermarket or a new gas station or whatever. And you know, and just see, because you could see them for quite a distance on a.
Wow.
So that's my Searchlight story. And it would be, it'd be interesting. It'd be kind of a fun little thing. And
it's like, I feel like in TV shows and stuff, that's like the big Hollywood premiere. You know, they had and then they had the searchlights going.
Well, we'd only have like one searchlight.
Oh, well. I've got Hollywood tastes, apparently.
So anyway, that's introduction to the Searchlight. Okay. I came across something about a recent ice storm in eastern Pennsylvania. Recent meaning June 1915. That was the title of it in the magazine thing, okay? Anyway, they were working during the day, but there's a lot of lines went down, as an ice storm would be. They were working during the day, but it was progressing too slowly. Then they decided, we'll start around the clock work with an Autocar searchlight. So Autocar, it was the trucks they were making down in Ardmore, Pennsylvania. So here's a quote from the article. The searchlight was brought in on a test as an assistant to the county's gas and electric station at Ardmore. The lighting company is enthusiastic over the assistance given by the outfit. So wherever the wires were they were fixing, they could just shine the searchlight up there and see during the day. And, again, I don't know how much damage it was, but that took care of it. So that was interesting. But what about this Autocar searchlight? Developed by the Autocar company down in Ardmore, it was designed and made for one of the belligerent powers.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
Belligerent.
And so I'm thinking, belligerent, well, you know, I've heard that, and I'm thinking, okay, it's usually a bad kid is a belligerent kid, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Do you know of any?
Yes.
Yeah. So I looked it up to, you know, get a better definition, and it was the Central Powers, the German Empire and the Austro-Hungarian Empire at the beginning of World War One. They were already fighting there in 1915 when this whole thing was done. But the United States, we're trying to keep our neutrality.
Yes.
And I remember hearing about Henry Ford wanted us to stay neutral, you know, and he was obviously a very well-known name, and, you know, there's all kinds, and it's kind of interesting reading that, and, you know, it's not anything to do with the Autocar searchlight truck, but just to hear what was going on, and Germany was, like, trying to get Mexico on her side and promise them part of the United States.
It's crazy.
I'm thinking,
yes, it's crazy, isn't it? Yeah.
And so we were kind of leaning towards Britain, but the Irish people in the United States, they didn't want us
don't
to.
Don't do that.
But anyway, it was interesting.
It's messy.
Okay, so anyway, so we're trying to stay neutral, we meaning the United States. So this truck was built for one of the belligerent powers. I never found anything out about if any of them actually got sent over there.
Wow.
I just read about this one. It was built on a regular two-ton chassis for a truck. And if you could show the first picture, please. And the caption underneath says, Autocar Military Searchlight on the March. And that's the whole unit. That's a truck. You can see two searchlights in the back and a bunch of rolls of wire cable there.
Wow.
Those lights would be powered by a Westinghouse generator, and the generator would be powered by a separate four-cylinder gasoline engine. So it was all in that unit right there. The searchlights themselves were 5,000 candle power. And I don't know, you know, a regular headlight on a car, what's the candle power? I don't know. And so I'm trying to go online and figure out, okay, what is 5,000 candle power equivalent to? Well, all you find is all these explanations what candle power is, how they figure it out, comparing it to lumens and all this stuff. And I'm thinking,
oh no,
I don't want that.
What's
Answer
the candle
my question.
Power of my car right now?
Yeah. So I don't really know what 5,000 candle power is. I don't think it's real, real bright though. But I put bright on my notes. But I
Big
take
letters.
That in.
Bright.
Yeah. Okay. In a test at League Island Navy Yard in Philadelphia, it threw a bright beam 1,500 yards, which is substantial. Okay.
Yeah.
That also got me investigating, what's League Island? And it's an island at the mouth of the Schuylkill River, site of the Philadelphia Naval Yard. They filled the channel in, so now it's part of the mainland, we'll say. And that I thought that was kind of interesting, because I spent a week down there when I was in the Navy. Little
did know
I
you
know,
were on League Island.
Yeah. But anyway, that's all that. So anyway, back to the lights. There were 14-inch diameter searchlights, and they were on little hand trucks, wire-wheeled, pneumatic-tired hand trucks, and they called them sulkies, which I don't know the definition of a sulky. I think of thing harness
racing. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And we used to have one in a museum. Do we still have that somewhere? I think I know where it is. Okay.
We had two. I think there's one in the carriage factory.
Okay. So we could race.
Yeah, you got to have two to race.
So if you look back to the first picture, and you can see the coils of cable on top. There was four cables, so there was two each for each light. There was two each. So you could take them, and you could move those lights a half mile away from the truck itself. So the thinking behind that, you can conceal the truck and the generator and take the lights up like on top of a mountain to either look for airplanes or enemy troops or other belligerent powers. And so you can go to the next picture, and there you go. They're kind of unloading the truck.
Ooh.
And it's kind of interesting because the guys aren't dressed too militarily like.
It looks like that guy's wearing like a collar and tie, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah. And I know that was kind of common dress back then, but not for the military. But anyway, so there you go.
Wow, that looks kind of unwieldy, doesn't it?
It does. And we're going to see in a moment or two another picture of the sulky up close. But this was used in for the New York State Militia near Poughkeepsie, New York. And they had 12 motor trucks for demonstration purposes. Now, this is 1915, okay? So they're still, you know, fighting against horse-drawn stuff, and they're going back and forth. So this is proof. They brought all these trucks in. I'm not sure exactly what all the trucks did besides the Autocar here. Then I found something, and this is actually what got me on this whole subject here. I saw something, an article right here sitting next to me, but the headline is Test Military Motors at Instruction Camp, and the subtitle was Fleet of 15 Trucks Placed at Disposal of U.S. Army Officers at New York Encampment. Machines are lent by manufacturers and owners and financed by banking firms. This is all privately financed and operated. Results of trials to be given to War Department. Major General Wood advocates formation of volunteer motor militia. That's all the subtitle, pretty big subtitle, okay? So let me talk about that. This was 4 weeks in August of 1915 near Plattsburgh, New York. So we're going way up almost to Canada there. And they drove these 15 trucks from New York City. It took them 4 days. And afterwards, they said it should have taken 2 days because they were breaking bridges and such. Again, these heavy trucks, you know, they were loaded with all sorts of stuff. They didn't quite know how to go and stuff, and I'm sure there was no paved roads, so it was quite interesting. And you know, I'm sitting here thinking, I know there was a transcontinental military thing. And Eisenhower was in it, and the story goes that he learned all about it so he could create the interstate highway system in the 50s. But I don't know what year that was, but again, they're trying to prove the validity of motorized vehicles compared to horses.
They did like an anniversary traveling of that. I'm trying to remember when that was.
That's right. Yes, I do remember.
So that
somebody
would be probably that would be 100 years.
Okay, but anyway, so they had to spend time strengthening and repairing bridges to support the weight of the trucks. The troop that was up there was comprised of business and professional men from New York City. There was a little bit over 1,000 lawyers and doctors and businessmen. I don't know.
That must be who's unloading the searchlight.
Okay. So it was all privately funded. So they were organized to conduct experiments and motor transportation machine gun units. They had something in there about horses or mules could go 25 miles a day. Trucks could do that same 25 miles in 2 to 3 hours, which was substantially shorter. Now we think it's silly.
That's ridiculous.
But again, breaking through bridges and mud roads and the whole deal. So 15 trucks. There was an armored car with a revolving gun, which was based on a Cadillac passenger car chassis. Two armored motorized trucks, three large ammunition trucks with field guns, one ambulance, one officer's car, one searchlight truck. Okay, the ambulance, officer's car, and searchlight truck were all Autocars. Okay, you can show the next picture now. And there we go. And so you see the two men on the left, and they got one of these sulkies, and they have handles there. And when you get to the place you want to set it up, the picture on the right shows the handles fold down and it makes the legs and so it sits there. Okay.
Wow.
So it's interesting with all these military maneuvers. I'm quoting this article. The searchlight car with its two lamps is proving of considerable value. For purely camp purposes, it is being used to illuminate the campground. I thought they were hunting down the enemy. Because there were two, they split them up in two groups and they played war and the whole thing. And that they were the same auto cars. I mentioned three of them, the ambulance, the officer's car, and searchlight truck that went to the place in outside of Peekskill that I mentioned earlier. So the next picture isn't the greatest, but it's at night. So it does show, and it's shiny. So
look at that caption, the eyes of the night.
Yes, the eyes of the night. And okay, so anyway, the I mentioned in the subtitle, Major General Wood. So Major General Leonard Wood commanded the whole encampment. And I think there's a fort named after him now. Anyway, he later stated that American motorists could be organized into a military motor corps. And he was talking along mostly the east and west coasts. And he said they could be organized because there's thousands of people with cars and stuff.
Yeah.
And he said, this is a duty. I'm quoting this. This is a duty that is before the motorists of the country. So he was kind of like,
you better do this.
Yeah.
And your patriotic duty.
And he said, you know, they have to standardize things because you have people, you know, with this car or that car, and it won't fit if you get a flat tire, if you need a part and all that stuff. But I was thinking about this also in 1915. Okay. We were a neutral country at the moment, but there were ships being sunk at sea in terms of war and stuff. And I'm thinking, was he thinking in case we got invaded somehow? You know, I mentioned about Germany and Mexico. Who knows? So it was kind of an interesting thing. So that talks about the Autocar Searchlight truck. But wait, there's more.
But wait.
Since we're on the subject of motorized searchlights, I came across something else.
Ooh.
And this is a company, Lubin, Arizona company.
Lubin?
L-U-B-I-N. Ever hear of it?
No.
Okay, the company was headed up by a guy called Romaine Fielding, which I like that name.
That's a great name.
And they had a car, 1915 Mitchell Deluxe 6, which was a seven-passenger touring car. 43 horsepower, 144-inch wheelbase, factory price, $2,350. That's besides the point. Anyway, he created Romaine Fielding, made it possible to take an entire lighting system anywhere that an automobile can travel. So if you show the next picture, it shows the Mitchell, and there it is, okay? The entire outfit weighs 8,000 pounds. That's 4 tons. So I'm not really sure what the car weighed in the first place. But anyway, that's
what bridge can support that?
That's a 13-inch searchlight on there, which is one less inch diameter. Okay. Now, remember how many candle power was
yeah.
in the other one? 5,000.
5,000.
This, and I saw it in two different places. It said 4.5 million candle power. And I'm thinking, and so that's really what got me thinking, what's a candle power? You know, you're going to be
that's
getting.
That's not for real.
You're going to get calls at the museum tomorrow from thousands of people. Anyway, the light also had a 2,000 foot long cable.
Oh my gosh.
I don't know if the generator, which is in the back of it, is. You can take it off the car and so I don't know. So anyway, you're wondering what is this car used for by the Lubin, Arizona company. Okay, Lubin, Arizona was a film company, 1915. Silent movies, of course.
Yeah.
Black and white,
yeah.
of course. Okay. He was in charge of making a movie. It was called The Great Divide, which was a Western drama in 1915. It was shot in Arizona and in the Grand Canyon. And I think there were some scenes that were done in caves, too. I just said that.
That's okay. cool.
The original cool. footage was directed by Romaine Fielding, but was deleted, then reshot and directed by Edgar Lewis. Okay? I'm not going to tell you the real plot because I didn't see it, except the Western drama. You know, I'm sure somebody gets tied to railroad tracks and, you know, the whole deal. let's see, what else was I going to say here? So that was that car. Now, you're writing down Lubin, L-U-B-I-N?
Yeah, but I'm also writing down The Great Divide because I like silent movies.
Okay, well, this is now it's going to get even, this is the cool part.
Ooh.
The cool part about my whole thing. Lubin, Arizona Company was a division of Lubin Manufacturing Company out of Philadelphia, which was an early film company. And when they started, they made their sets on top of roofs of houses. And there's a picture of one in the thing. And then later on, they went in the studio. And they realized right in the beginning, the movie industry, you know, we could do something. And so they were early one. They kind of skyrocketed up and some things happened and they skyrocketed it back down. Okay. So if you are in like Philadelphia, you're coming towards Reading on 422. So you're going 422 West. Okay.
Yeah.
You're like in Valley Forge.
Yeah.
And in the casino places there
yep.
on your right. And you're going to go over to Schuylkill River. As soon as you go over, you look to your right, and right along the river, there's a long, low building with a field. That was the studio. And I knew
really?
That. I already knew that, okay? So there you go. So I assume every one of our viewers is going to be down there tomorrow.
I'll be
okay?
there.
So how about some famous actors? How about Pearl White? Okay, we know who Pearl White is because we have our dial car made in Reading, and apparently she had one at one time.
Yep.
Why, I don't know, you know, because she could have had any car.
Yeah, really.
She could have had a Daniels. Okay, here's another famous actor, and this is like the cool one here. How about Alan Hale? Skipper's father.
Wow.
Yeah.
I do believe they look pretty similar,
they
don't
do.
They? Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
They kind of overact the same way, too.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
Take it, Alan. It's
just interesting, you know, that you know, this was cutting edge technology, whether it was a military truck or this Mitchell automobile that, you know, we had bright lights out on location.
Yeah, so basically this is a location lighting.
Yeah, yeah.
Vehicle.
And you can see in the front of it there's a bunch of little spotlights.
I was looking at that.
Spotlights.
It's got like five headlights, it looks like, in the front.
So, I don't know. I'm thinking, would all of those lights all at the same time be 4.5 million candle power?
Wow.
I don't know. It doesn't really make any that much difference. It's just kind of the story behind it, I think, is a cool thing.
That's cool.
Okay.
Fox Searchlight Pictures.
Who? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Fox, right.
Yeah, see?
Yeah, okay. All right.
That's cool.
Yep.
All right. Okay. We're not moving too far time-wise, actually, but subject-wise we are. So, if you've been watching this show for a long time.
You get a medal.
Yes. Don't collect it yet. I don't have them ready. we've spoken on here before about the Chadwick Automatic Road Guide and Lee Chadwick, really. I know we've talked about the road guide. You did.
Mm-hmm.
I think we talked about Searchmont, correct?
Recently,
which was
the
predecessor, I guess. Mm-hmm. Of the Chadwick automobile. So Lee Chadwick made these really luxurious, top-of-the-line cars in Pottstown, Pennsylvania. Museum does not have one. We really want one. So if anyone out there has one in their garage, give us a call.
Yeah. It has to be a big garage, too.
Yeah, they're big. Get it out of your way,
big,
you know.
Big, powerful cars.
We'll take care of it. But yeah, there's not many left, so I wonder why. I mean, I guess he didn't make that many, but still. Like,
yeah, I don't know
where they went.
How many he made. Yeah.
But anyway, Lee Chadwick, eventually he got fed up with cars and the car industry, and he decided to focus on this invention that he came up with, which is the Chadwick Automatic Road Guide. And I have a photo of it here. Or an illustration of it, I'm sorry. It's really a pretty ingenious little thing. He came up with it, I think he had it patented in 1910, if I remember correctly. But so basically, this hooks up to your car odometer, and there's a cable that would hook up to it. This is mounted in the car with you, the driver, so you can see it as you're driving. And basically, there's a disc in there, and you can see it in there. It looks like it's got little holes all through it. Those little holes, as the disc turns, these little pins that are, you know, spring mounted, they kind of punch through those holes and then trigger this directional indicator, which is up in those windows up there. And a couple of them are up that you can see it in the illustration. Looks like the veer left one is up all the way to the left.
And a railroad crossing is like a double cross.
Yes, that's the railroad crossing on the right. And then that D, I do believe, means danger.
Danger.
Danger. Danger. Will Robinson. Danger.
And I got to say, the buttons on the bottom, you can see the row of buttons. There's one that kind of sort of looks like the Star David there.
Yes.
That means there's a speed trap in town.
That's my
favorite. For the cop.
Can you Can you imagine? What is a speed trap in 1910 on a dirt road with a two-cylinder car?
And it might not be a speed trap. It just might be an over-exuberant police officer.
Yes. Small town. Mm-hmm. Needs a little cash in the coffers. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
But you would buy this for a route that you wanted to take. So we're sitting here at the studio in Reading. So let's say we wanted to go back to Boyertown tonight, and you could buy the disc that went from Reading to Boyertown, and there you go. It's a pretty cool device. Mm-hmm. We have two of these on display at the museum, so you should definitely check that out. They're in a case. But I'm not really here to talk about this device or Lee Chadwick, because we've done that before. But there were other devices like this kind of at the same time, and some of them are pretty interesting. So I'm going to look at one of those devices, which we don't have an example of, although we do mention it kind of briefly in the case with the Chadwick. But I'm going to go in a little more depth with it tonight. So I'm going to look at one that was called the Rhodes Pathfinder. And this was invented by J.B. Rhodes. And there's a photo of him. It's not it's not a terribly clear photo, I apologize. But it's a funny photo. He's there with his hunting dogs, and he's got his grouse that he shot strung up there behind him. There's other photos of him out there that are kind of like...
Oh, there we go.
He's very serious. I like this one. It's also going to kind of sort of come up in some of his other inventions. He's an interesting fellow. So he was known as, I've seen, Kalamazoo's most prolific inventor. I also read he was Kalamazoo's Edison.
Okay.
So
makes sense.
He has a lot of patents. Mm-hmm. I'm not even going to cover a fraction of them. He has over 200 patents in his name. But in 1891, I think this is a really small photo. Maybe the nice folks in the studio can make it bigger. I am 99% certain that this is him. I only found this photo in like a brochure for Kalamazoo, like the Kalamazoo Tourism Board. And there's no caption on it. It mentions him though in the script by it, and I'm pretty sure that's him holding the tiller there. So in 1891, he came up with a steam-powered wagon. I don't think he built another one. I think that was it. But he came up with this. He was pretty young. He was, I guess, 24 at the time. He came up with this, and he was kind of an oddball in the town driving this thing around. What he really wanted to do with this steam wagon, he was trying to basically take people from Kalamazoo to Gull Lake, which was like one of those resort type towns, maybe 15 miles away from Kalamazoo, Michigan. And back then, of course, we had it here in the Reading area too, these resort kind of places out in the country, and with the healing springs and the water, and it was a very Victorian thing. People really were into that. So he really was kind of coming up with like a taxi, really. They didn't have to use horses.
And what year was that again, roughly?
1891.
Wow, okay.
Yeah. I kind of think of him as like a James Hill type almost, James Hill. For those of you who may not know, at the museum we have something called the Hill Car, which is named for its builder, James Hill. And he was a young man in Fleetwood who came up with this carriage, really, that he didn't want to have a horse with. And he put a steam engine on it, and it was kind of an oddball thing in town because he did it supposedly earlier than this, 1891, but it was the only one he made, and he had a couple of patents in his name too. I don't think as many, and they were all for totally non-related things. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Nothing makes sense with another one. It's right. all different right. stuff. So this guy seems kind of similar in a way. I guess that's why he intrigues me. So he did have lots of patents, including spouts for oil bottles. We have ones that look similar to this mm-hmm. By our gas station in the museum. Glass bottle with the metal spout on it. He made a spout that, this is a different patent, but he made a spout that essentially you could put on like a glass canning jar that you had at your house. You didn't have to get, you know, mm-hmm. the fancy jar,
right.
the set jar. So that's one thing he did. He patented razor blades. That's a more conservative photo of the good man. He's older when he does this. He came up with different razor blades. I think these were on display actually at the Gilmore Museum.
The picture there in the label, he's clean shaven.
He is.
Which is a good advertisement
it is
for razor blades.
Very good. Well, he is trying to tell me it's for a perfect shave, so he better demonstrate as such.
Whoa.
He also came up with a bunch of fishing lures.
Okay.
Which is why I think he was really into hunting. A hunting photo cracks
okay.
me up. So, yeah, this one, it's like a little frog type thing. You know, I found like a family, you know where I found a family history of these people, which was the Rhodes family, which is really interesting. It was on like the National Fly Fishing Foundation. Yeah.
Okay.
Apparently his brother also was into this stuff, and which makes sense because when I was searching for patents, I kept coming across, oh, he invented this lure. Okay, so I'm searching for a lure, and this Bert Rhodes comes up. I'm like, who's Bert? I'm looking for Jay. And it was his brother. So apparently apparently this one on your screen, which Jay did, was they had a really difficulty mass producing it for whatever reason. Like,
Frank probably just kept hopping away.
good old Bert came to the rescue and fixed up this patent so it could be mass produced. So he was into that. Oh, this is another small photo, but this is good. You'll like this, Dan. This is Jay and Bert. They're sitting in the front of the car. Jay's all the way to the left of your photo without the hat on. And all the fish they've caught, supposedly with their lures that they made, are strung up by their 1907 Cadillac there.
Mm.
Not sure who the ladies are. I thought that was a great photo. So he's an interesting fellow. He also invented, getting back a little bit into transportation, he also invented a road grader that the scraper blade mounted under the tractor chassis with the blade being pivotable about a horizontal axis disposed perpendicular to the blade. Did you get all that?
Nope.
Neither did I.
Sort of distracted.
Yeah, there's some emergency services going on outside. I don't know if you guys can hear that, but we have this nice big window in front of us, and mm-hmm. we get to see all the action in the city as we're talking. But yeah, there's like a sort of a front-on view. So he was also into...
That road grader, what year would that have been?
Let's see, that is 1903.
So it's probably horse-drawn at that time.
Yep,
still.
Probably.
Because
yeah.
I've seen some horse-drawn road graders, and they're very...
If that's the side, you kind of have to cock your head because it's, you know... It's not rotated incorrectly. He had to go the long ways to fit it on here. Mm-hmm. But anyway, it looks like a wagon seat up there, and there doesn't look like a steering wheel, so to speak. It looks like you would sit like on that wagon type seat. like you said, and have a horse. I think that wheel in the center there, you can see, is for the guy actually grading the road. He's not steering the thing or, but so whatever.
Move the blade.
It's interesting. Mm-hmm. So he was really into that as well. He also, this I was not expecting, he came up with a device for railroad cars to make it easier to dump cargo out. So on a big construction project, you know, if you're excavating, you're getting rid of a lot of dirt. So what was going on is, you know, the steam shovel or whatever would load up the individual cars, and then wherever you're going to unload the dirt, those cars would be unloaded individually. That takes a lot of time. Mm-hmm. So if I'm understanding how this works properly, essentially they're making a train cars where the one side doesn't have a wall on it, or at least it's a so you have a line of 10. You'd almost have like one big, long, removable wall along all 10 of them. And you kind of angle, when you put the dirt in the car, you kind of angle it that it leans up towards that removable wall. And then you go to the dump site, take that all out, and everything gets emptied at once. Who needs a big project like that? You don't, Dan?
No.
Well, they did when they built the Panama Canal.
Oh, okay.
So this, he helped basically create this method of dumping the dirt that was very valuable in building the Panama Canal. So the U.S. government supposedly paid him $2 million for this invention. Now, back in the Panama Canal was built, it took, I think, 1904 to 1913 or 14 is when it was done. $2 million back then is quite a big chunk of change. So he made like maybe $25 million off of that in today's money. Mm-hmm. Today's money would be about $25 million. But as I read somewhere, you know, he didn't rest on his laurels when he did that. He kept inventing stuff.
Probably invented a 4.5 million candle power.
There you go. You have no, maybe he did. Well, like those razor blades came after this. He's the man still thinking about how to make a better razor blade, and he's got all that money. So then, and actually after this too, is when he comes up with what we're here to talk about tonight, which is the Rhodes Pathfinder. So. Oh, and it was the Rhodes Pathfinder, a perfect mechanical road guide. Doesn't that sound lovely? So he filed this application on July 27th, 1910. And, you know, about a year later is when he gets the patent, a little over a year. It's a mechanical device, and it's programmed by hand. So, have you ever... I know Dan has. Dan's heard of the Blue Book. I don't know if we've talked. I think we've talked about the Blue Book on here.
I've heard about the Blue Book, yes.
Maybe briefly.
I think briefly.
So the Automobile Blue Book at this time was a book, literally a book, pages and pages of directions to different places. And you could buy them by region. So, like, you buy the New England region or the Mid-Atlantic or the Southern, the Midwest or whatever. And you would look up routes. You'd look up the route from Reading to Boyertown. You'd look up the route from Philadelphia to, oh, my gosh.
Harrisburg.
Hello, thank you. I can't think of a town that's different. So, yeah, you would... look this up, and it would tell you, you know, start at Penn and Second in Reading, and you have to go this. You have to turn exactly where they tell
you. Usually, they start right in the center of town.
Usually, yes, they would.
And you set your odometer at 0.0. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because it would give you, you know, travel on Penn for 2 miles.
Yeah, and then you make a left turn or whatever, and then it just a cumulative mileage.
Yes. Yep. Hopefully. And sometimes the instructions were not as nice as turn onto Second Street. It was turn at the big red inn. Yeah.
But you think if a Autocar Searchlight truck was ahead of you,
you'd
the
see
bridge
everything.
Might be out. And you'd have to go
that's
a different
true.
Way.
I thought maybe you'd see. No, the bridge would be gone. Yeah. Well, you could see the bridge was gone. So so that was, like I said, it was a book that you bought. So you would still need this book. So before you left on your trip, you'd sit down with your book as a reference, and you would program this Pathfinder to the book. So you'd kind of spin all those dials in there to go from point A to point B. So now there's what it looks like when, you know, it's back in its brass tube.
So what is the gauge on the right there?
I think that is a speedometer.
Okay.
You can see the little cable there running down.
Yes.
It gets cut off.
So I guess it implies that cable would be driving both. Okay, that makes sense.
And then there's a lever there, or a little dial, like all the way to the left, I think. Or it could be that little switch by the cable. I'm not sure. One of those would take it out of gear. So, like, let's say you're driving along and you get hungry and you see a restaurant. Well, if you take a turn and go down even a little bit off to the side to go to that, you've just messed up your whole thing. So you could turn it out off of gear, go eat your lunch, come back to where you turned it off, and then proceed.
So you're going, and somehow this tells you when to turn.
Yes.
What's the visual there?
So it's really difficult to see, but you see how at the top of the, okay, the cylinder's running the long ways there. There's a little white square.
I see it.
In the middle of that cylinder. Now, on my screen, I can see that it says R6. So R would be right, and 6 would be miles. So basically, in 6 miles, you turn right.
Okay.
And so, and the dial, if I'm understanding this correctly, the dial that says 6 will turn, you know, as it'll say 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Got it. So when you had the photograph of it opened up, and you can see that, there's a lot of little dials there.
Yes.
And they're all, okay.
It's a little insane. That is what it would look like mounted in your car. Mount to your steering column so you, I think that looks a little complicated, but hey, that's me. Kind of goes behind your steering wheel.
Yeah.
There was also a bell in there, too, that would ring to signal they had to do something. At first, I thought there were different bells for different directions, but no, it just signals that a turn is about to come up. So, why would you want this? Because you have the book, right? You have the blue book. Why do you need this thing to tell you all that? Essentially, the two big things that he was on about was, what if you're driving by yourself and you don't have a passenger to read the book for you? You know, kind of hard to sit there and read a book as you're going when you lose your spot because you had to look up and watch the road, which you shouldn't be doing. So that was one thing. The other thing was, if you're driving like in the evening or at night, who can sit there and read a book in an open car like that?
So you're saying that is illuminated?
I don't know if it was illuminated, but I guess it was, if it's on a white background in the dark and it's simple L5, it's a little
I have a thought about that. I don't think people would be traveling at night.
Not like they were. No.
If they were, it would be just around town where you wouldn't need it.
Where you wouldn't need it, yeah.
And I don't see, you know, if it's above your steering column like that, you know, I I mean, you know, you're driving now. Yeah. You look at the gauges. You know, yeah. You just glance down. So
yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it's a neat idea. It's you know, in this brass tube, but oh, and it came with a 5-year guarantee. I should note, apparently. However, it's complicated. It's very complicated to set, to program, essentially. It's okay. It's very complicated to program, so that's one thing that really hurts it. I did find the patent drawings of it, just so you can kind of see, like, you know, there again, that little window there with all the dials moving. So you'd have like an alternating ring, like you'd have the directional ring, and then next to it would be a mileage ring. Mm-hmm. And then the mileage ring was even was broken down into tenths of a mile. That's what all those other little smaller marks in there were. I mean,
wow.
It's complicated. It's really complicated. So that's not super helpful as far as selling it. So I love that. And there's the 1910 issue of the automobile. I love this, how they like, you know, describe it, and it's long, but I love this. This little director of the movements of a touring party will perform even better than a flesh and blood guide. It is on the job all the time, never making a haphazard guess as to distance traveled or having its attention diverted by any of the thousand distractions inseparable from an automobile tour. But programming it is difficult.
Mm-hmm. I don't know about difficult, it's just time consuming, it seems.
Right, right.
A better word.
And if you had a navigator with you, mm-hmm. I'm not doing that. Here, you read where I'm supposed to go.
Yeah.
But it's a cool little thing. I don't know of many that are left.
So I should be looking for one at Hershey when I go.
Sure, take a look. See if you can find one. I think the Gilmore Museum had one on display for a bit. I don't know if it's permanently theirs or if it was loaned to them. They had a little exhibit of his stuff in general, which is that cool razor blade photo. But yeah, so that's the Rhodes Pathfinder, just an oddball mm-hmm. thing. And we get to talk about the Chadwick a lot because we have one, and it's local too, so that's really cool. But this is another one that I think is pretty interesting. So well, everyone, we are out of time here this month, so we will be back in July with some new stuff to talk about and some more reminders about cool stuff that's coming up at the museum. And until then, stay safe. Enjoy the beginning of your summer. We hope that those summer plans include a visit to see us sometime. And we will see you in July. Thank you.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.